other way?
That works. Hurry up. Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to start with our chants. We're so thankful for everybody to come out here so that the U.S. government, those in power, don't think they can just wage endless war on the backs of poor and working people. So we say, money first, job, then education, not for war and occupation. Money for jobs and education!
Not for war and occupation!
Money for jobs and education!
Not for war and occupation!
Money for jobs and education!
Not for war and occupation!
Money for healthcare and education!
Not for war and occupation!
Money for healthcare and education!
Not for war and occupation!
Money for housing and education!
Not for war and occupation!
Money for housing and education!
Not for war and occupation!
No justice, no peace! US out of the Middle East! No justice,
no peace!
US out of the Middle East! No justice,
no peace!
U.S. out of the Middle East, no justice!
No peace!
U.S. out of the Middle East, no justice!
No peace!
U.S. out of the Middle East, no justice!
No peace!
U.S. out of the Middle East!
No peace!
Crime! Occupation is a crime! My brothers and sisters, starting with the program, we have Rick Sterling, the Marin Task Force on the Americas.
Yeah, hello everybody. It's great to see everybody here. Task Force on the Americas has been working for 35 years, taking tours to South America, to Central America. We've sent delegations to Honduras, to Uruguay, to Cuba upcoming, to Venezuela. We had observers in Honduras for the Honduran election. We had observers in Venezuela around the time of the election there. U.S. is deathly afraid of the dramatic changes that are sweeping what they used to call our backyard. The U.S. was a part of the coup that overthrew the liberal government in Honduras in 2009. The U.S. is part of the attempt to destabilize Venezuela. They're calling Venezuela a threat to the U.S. It's not a threat to the American people, by no means. Venezuela sent fuel oil to poverty communities on the east coast of the U.S. just a few years ago when they had a bitter cold winter. Venezuela is a representative of the American people. It's our friend. It's an enemy of Wall Street. It's an enemy of the U.S. empire. It's standing up to empire. So I would ask anybody who's interested in joining Task Force on the Americas to speak with one of our members who are over here with the banner, Task Force on the Americas. And it's great to be in solidarity with you here today. Hugo Chavez was an inspiration for Venezuela. He led them. He died 2 years ago. He's still a symbol of justice and freedom. When I say Hugo Chavez, you say presente. Hugo Chavez. Hugo Chavez. Hugo Chavez. Thank you very much.
Thank you for that. Obama says endless war. We say no more. Obama says endless war.
We say no more.
Obama says endless war.
We say no more.
Obama says endless war.
We say no more.
Obama says endless war.
We say no more.
My brothers and sisters, our next speaker is Father Louis Vitelli, just back from the Greek drone base protest. So please welcome Father Louis.
Here you are again. I come from a family. My father was born here in 1902. He came over here to get away from the thought they could get away from fueling war. Then they found out that everybody was being drafted sent to war. But I was sent to war. I was supposed to go to war to fight in Korea. Now, isn't that a nice thought? Guess what? I never happened. I was kind of upset that I got in just as they were stopping fighting. Okay, yes. Right now, we're in one war after another. It's impossible. And the president, who was elected thinking he would stop wars, has got a budget for $50 billion. Not million, not trillion, now it's $50 billion.
Yes,
to redo all of our weapons, $3 billion for the nuclear bomb, $3
billion,
and Mr. Marie,
Mara Gates, and I figured out, maybe if I put Dave, I'll do this with my team.
Yeah, Mr. Mara is in prison, County Kelly is in prison, and now down in, if this was, if we were Jeju Island in Korea, we would be out here, and the bishop would be out there. The bishop there, he calls all the people to go to jail. He has all the time to send them over to find out from me, who's been working with people in San Francisco, got the red signed the red like last week. He went out there. We were able to stop them. Maybe they had one or two or three people. Nailed down some of the old folks, some of the other folks. But it's right there, right next to the test site where they're testing nuclear bombs. Still testing nuclear bombs, which is still part of Dallas Air Force Base and probably the largest storage of nuclear bombs in this part of the world. And yeah, we want more and more and more. And so we've got to stop this crazy war. Nobody wants it. I went to Iran to say, people had put out, we had a group here. And we met the day that Bush had said that, this is our enemy.
It looks like it's going to be our.
I was terrible.
We said, no, these are the good people. And all these people I thought we were going to fight with, nobody wants to fight. We didn't want to fight. The people that they're not Muslims. I get so upset when people say they're all out and they have to kill people. Even my own dear sister, who I buried a few weeks ago, I'm still trying to convince her no religion wants to kill people. I went over to the school, the top school in Iran, the top school in the Quran, and they go on and on and on. And I have Mennonites go there to study, because they want to study all the religions because they're pacifists and they believe in that. And if they went to stay there 5 minutes, if they were trying to stop war, we got to stop this crazy war. We're the city of Bradford in love. And so let's really live like those people. Not the brain, it's the heart that's supposed to be running the world. We've got to be in everybody. We all love each other. Look at how everybody here. We're having a love in, like the old love in we have here. That's the real thing. That's the real San Francisco. So let's stop this war and stop this. These are all these big people. It's the billionaires right here in the finance district. And that's the ones that are making the decisions. That's not coming from the brain, it's coming from the heart. Should be coming from the brain. So they don't know their biology, they don't know their medicine, they don't know anything about compromise, love. They don't know enough about love. So we gotta all love each other like Pope Pete. They're everywhere showing love. What did we have? 30 people there? That creech, Code Pink, we had about 30 of Code Pink there, all getting arrested. We got to go to court again and again and again. And the DFC wrote more about it. So let's make a peace. This is San Francisco. We should be the leaders in peace. Peace now.
Peace now.
Peace now.
What do you want?
Peace now.
What do we want?
Peace now.
What do we want?
Peace now.
Okay, thank you.
Good afternoon, San Francisco. My name is Lana Kiswani. I'm with AROC, the Arab Research and Organizing Center, and we're very happy to be here with you today to lift up the voices of the Arab people that are resisting from Iraq to Palestine, from Egypt to Tunisia, from right here in your own backyard in San Francisco. We all say no to war. If you guys recall, in 2001, we stood out here to stand against the war on Afghanistan. And then people told us, it's just the war on Afghanistan, and it's justified. And we said no. They told us in 2001 that Afghanistan had nothing to do with Latin America, that Afghanistan had nothing to do with Africa, that Afghanistan had nothing to do with Southeast Asia. And we told them, we know better. In 2003, we mobilized the hundreds of thousands of people right here in San Francisco against the war on Iraq. We knew then, and we know now, that U.S. war is about empire. That the war on Iraq is the same war that's on the Palestinian people. The war on Iraq is the same war against Afghanistani people. The war on Iraq is the same interest of the interventions in the Philippines, the interventions in Latin America, the interventions in Syria. We know that when they do warmongering and try to convince the U.S. public and the international community that Iran is our next target, that Syria is our next target, that the Palestinian people are our ongoing target, we know that we say no to war. Woo! They told us in 2003 that Palestine had nothing to do with Iraq. They tried to tell us that we can't raise the flag of Palestine on the stages against the war, anti-war protest. They told us recently that we can't talk about Palestine and the uprisings and the mobilizations in support of Egypt and Tunisia. And the Arab people and all people of conscience knew better. We know that the Zionist state, that Israel, is part and parcel of the U.S. war and empire. Violence in this country, so too will the occupation of Palestine and all over the Arab world, and so too will U.S. empire. So we say no to Zionism. We say no to occupation. We stand with the resistance of the Iraqi people. We stand with the resistance of the Palestinian people. And as Arabs and as third world people, we also stand with the resistance of black and brown people in this country. Today is the anniversary of the murder of Alex Nieto. We cannot talk about Palestine war and occupation without talking about police violence in this country. We cannot talk about empire without talking about state violence. We know that the murder of Alex Nieto, the murder of Oscar Grant, of Trayvon Martin, are all inextricably linked to the war and occupation in our homeland. We know that state violence here feeds empire, and we know that empire feeds state violence, and we will march here today, and we will continue to speak out against all forms of war and empire. Woo! In that spirit, I want you guys all to chant with me. From the river to the sea, Palestine will be free. From the river to the sea,
Palestine will be free.
From the river to the sea,
Palestine will be free.
Come on, you guys have to be a little louder. We have that flag behind you that's maintaining and holding that spirit up, and let that flag wave with the echoes of your voices. From the river to the sea,
Palestine will be free.
From the river to the sea,
Palestine will be free.
On that note, our next speaker is from World Can't Wait. Please invite Stephanie to the stage.
Hey, everybody. Listen, a shout out to our sisters and brothers who are marching today in Washington, D.C. They are marching to the White House, where they will have a die-in. They have been leaving flag-draped coffins in front of the offices of warmakers, holding teach-ins. They've been in the streets. This is their fourth day. Please give a shout out to Spring Rising in Washington, D.C. So, everybody knows this. The leaders and deciders and commanders of the U.S. Empire have a lot of stuff. They got drones. They got nukes. They got troops. They got generals. They got puppet governments, which they try to adjust at will. They've got kill lists. They've got Guantanamo, which was set up to tell the world that all of this can be done to anybody, anytime the U.S. feels like it. But here's the one thing the rulers of this empire do not have in their hands, and that is the interests of humanity. What they have in their hands, on their hands, is the blood of over a million Iraqi people. Yes. And the living agony of 4 to 5 million displaced refugees and 2 million widowed women and 5 million orphaned kids. That's on the hands of the U.S. Empire. And what they do not have, they never will have. We are responsible because we live in this country for raising up a resistance that is powerful enough to stop these crimes. And just, this is the 12th anniversary of shock and awe, but just like what this empire has done to Afghanistan and Syria and Libya and all across the region, as sister was speaking before me said, what it could now well try to do to Iran as well, and just like what the U.S. partner Israel has been doing to the people of Palestine, this brutality, this carnage, and this chaos is the product and proof of an empire that seeks domination by any means available. Now, that's a high-stakes goal, and none of this has gone all their way all this time. But 12 years after shock and awe, if you look at the consequences of U.S. policy and practice in the region, both intended and unintentional, this empire can speak of itself as the world's leading democracy, bringing democracy to the people of the Middle East and North Africa. But in reality, the U.S. is absolutely incapable of bringing liberation to anybody, anywhere. Nothing good for the people will come from more war and occupation in the service of this empire. And I want to answer a question a reporter just asked me. Why is it that millions marched in 2003? Why is it that even in 2008, the anti-war movement was much, much larger because people had come to see and hate Bush regime's occupation and wars? Why are so many people now out of the streets and even worse, drawn into accepting new wars today? I think there's different reasons, but one main reason right now is that people are being fooled and bamboozled behind the excuse and the lie that anything the U.S. does is justified because somebody has to stop ISIS. Well, where did ISIS come from? It was a response to the U.S. hand in the region. It was literally fueled and armed by billions of dollars of U.S. arms thrown all over the place. And it's been funded by U.S. allies, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, and Turkey. Nothing the U.S. does is going to stop the violence of ISIS. ISIS is a reactionary and violent and brutal force. It has nothing good for the people under its control. But ISIS is bad, and the U.S. empire is far worse. It has been, it is now, and it's going to be until it stops. I know that is controversial out beyond this ring of people, but this is what we have to go out and argue with people about. You cannot let your government do with ISIS what they did with weapons of mass destruction, which is get all the people in this country to think we have no choice but to follow this government into war. Okay, I've got to stop. I just want to say, World Can't Wait says crimes are crimes no matter who does them. Please go to our website. We have a new timeline up starting 3 days after 9/11 going to the present. You can use it to argue with people as to what the nature of this war is and why they should stand against it and join in the protest. We also have the open letter to the people of Iran, which was initiated by the Answer Coalition. We want you to come on our website, sign the letter. It was done in response to the reactionary letter by the 47 senators who are threatening Iran, and this is a good response. It's something we can do today. And overall, I want to say to the youth, Sister Lara is absolutely correct. Oscar Grant, Trayvon Martin, Eric Garner, Michael Brown, they also live in Iraq and Afghanistan and Syria. And if we can go out in our hundreds of thousands, which was so beautiful, to stop police murder and terror in this country, that same outrage and tears and anger and determination need to come forth in the streets today against these wars. The world can't wait.
Money for a job and education, not for war and occupation. Money for a job and education,
not for war and occupation.
Money for housing and education,
not for war and occupation.
Money for a job and education,
not for war and occupation.
Our next speaker is Mazda from the Party for Socialism and Liberation.
Brothers and sisters, it's great to be here. Many of us have been here time and time again for 12 years, really before that. So 12 years ago at this time, the U.S. and its junior imperialist partner invaded Iraq. Why? Well, they told us weapons of mass destruction. They told us that there's the danger of a mushroom cloud over Washington, D.C. And if you took that reasoning at face value, it seemed outrageous. Iraq had been under sanctions for 12, 13 years. Over a million Iraqis had lost their lives because they hadn't had access to medicine, to food. How could a country that had been bombed continuously for 12 years be a danger to Washington? But when you think of the real reason, of course everyone knows the weapons of mass destruction was a bogus justification, but the real reason was that an independent state in Iraq, a state that was not run by Washington, was a threat. The same way that Venezuela is a threat to Washington and Wall Street. The same way that the governments of Iran and Syria are a danger to Washington and Wall Street. It's not the people, there are no dangers to the people, there are no threats, but to Wall Street and to the policymakers who try to make the world safe for the expansion of their interests. These are dangerous governments, these are dangerous people. At the time, and throughout these years and now, many of us have been tying, just like the previous speakers, have been tying the struggles of the different peoples against the rule of empire, and it's very important. Right now, there's a split in the U.S. ruling class. When Netanyahu visited the U.S., part of the U.S. ruling class, the part that Netanyahu is very much trying to encourage, the fascist Netanyahu, is to bomb Iran, is not to engage in any negotiations with it. The same way that Netanyahu was encouraging an attack, an invasion on Iraq, he's doing the same thing on Iran. And the thing that we have to be clear about is that while there are real differences in Washington, while there are real differences between Democrats and Republicans about what tactics to take, whether to bomb Iran or to sanction Iran or to reach some agreements to limit what it can do, their aims are the same. There's no difference there. There's no disagreement there. Again, they want to subjugate another independent state. They want to make the world safe for Wall Street. And we have to be very clear about that. We have to be very clear about the ties of the different struggles. The fact that the Palestinian people have been subjected to violent crimes, massacres by the Israeli state, by the criminal Israeli state that's now headed by Netanyahu. The fact that Netanyahu openly states that we were not even going to try to pretend to pursue a two-state solution, it tells us one thing. And what it tells us is not just the crimes of the Israeli state, but the crimes of the U.S. government that is using, that has used the Israeli state to subjugate the peoples of the Middle East.
And even though it's not in effect yet, and it's actually ruled unconstitutional by the Philippine government, we have seen the EDCA kill and murder the Filipino transgender woman Jennifer Lande in October last year. She was murdered by an 18-year-old U.S. Marine Pemberton. A U.S. Marine who's only 19 who has caused so much hate in this country that he murdered someone in the Philippines and now is under the U.S. jurisdiction and not being served time in the Philippines where he committed the crime. Reminding us the Philippines is just a doormat to the United States. And not only that, but in January, the U.S. backed an operation called Operation Exodus that killed 60 Filipino lives and put even the Philippine military lives in line and killed 44 Philippine military men that is now calling for our puppet government to resign because of its connivance with the United States as they feel used as pawns by the U.S. military and the Philippine government. That is how intimately we are being affected right now. And just to speak, I even received an email from a friend of mine, Brandon Lee, who used to organize his buy-in USA, a San Francisco native, a Chinese-American San Francisco native that moved to the Philippines to wage that imperialist struggle. He is being politically vilified and criminalized by the Philippine government. He's being followed by state agents that are actually backed
by Nihan, an operation, a counterterrorism operation that is backed by the United States. So they criminalize us and they push us out of our country, take our resources. And here we are thrown here. So back then, I just felt overwhelmed with how my narrative as a Filipino was shared, the same narrative with Palestinians, people from Iraq, people from Colombia, Venezuela, South Korea. And today I stand here and it's the same thing, if not even worse. And I know although imperialism is thriving all over the world, especially in third world countries, I also know that people's resistance in those countries, in my homeland especially, are thriving and are rising.
Yeah.
And so I am calling for you all here, as my countrymen, as my homeland wages an anti-imperialist struggle, for all of us here to also build a movement that wages anti-imperialism in the belly of the beast. The same system that justifies the killing of black lives and military season and funding this broken racist system in this country. So I'm calling for us to really build together and get to know each other, because the ills in this country will not end until imperialism ceases to exist in our homelands and our third world countries. So long live international solidarity, and thank you all. Woo!
Sister, our next speaker is Eleanor from Coping.
Good, thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
We're trying to put all those.
Hi, everybody. I'm Eleanor, representing
Coping.
All of the previous speakers have led the way for what we want to say, so we can be very brief. At one point, can you come along? I was wedded to war. But,
thank you.
But one day I learned that I could be divorced from war and married, wedded to peace and justice. We will win in this fight against American imperialism, American empire. We are urging people to fight on every level that is possible. Code Pink began in 2002 in response to the Iraq War, and we've continued to fight with all of our comrades out here and others that are not here today to end endless, borderless war. We encourage all of you to call your senators and call your representatives. A lot of people say, what good will it do? But no AUMF. We think this is one that we can win. No AUMF. Authorized use of military force against, it says, ISIL. But we know that that means endless, waterless war. Join us. No AUMF. We can win. We will win. Call your senator, call your representative, and keep up the good fight. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to bring it to Latin America now, so please welcome Gloria Lariva with the Bay Area Latin America Solidarity Coalition.
Sisters and brothers, we often are here protesting against U.S. policy and the challenges that we're facing, but I want to start by saying that all the Cuban Five are home and free in Cuba. And a great symbol of resistance to the U.S. empire anywhere in the world. I'm talking today on behalf of the Bay Area Latin America Solidarity Coalition for the people of Venezuela, their president, and their revolutionary government, which is under threat by the United States. On March 9, you know that President Obama declared Venezuela an extraordinary threat to the national security and foreign policy of the United States. I think that sentence is enough. We know that the U.S. is a threat to the safety, security, and lives of the people of the world. And when we see the destruction of the Middle East, of millions murdered, of hundreds of thousands of soldiers wounded permanently, of thousands murdered, of destruction of society,
meet the needs of their people, we say this: you will not touch Latin America. You will not touch Venezuela, Obama, because the people of the world are standing up. We ask you today, there's a sign going around that's being taken a picture, tweet, millions of tweets, 10 million signatures. In fact, I think we'll meet that goal and surpass it, to say, Obama, repeal the executive order now. It's right in front of me there. And I want to ask you this. Let's remember that international solidarity and action is the most important thing. The majority of people in the U.S. are against this war in the Middle East. So we today have to show it with our march, our action, our public stance. Thank you very much. Que viva!
Courageous, it's illegitimate, and it doesn't have to be this way. Look at Iraq. They invaded Iraq to make it a platform of empire and were willing to murder a million people, drive 5 million people from their homes, and strengthen oppression. But they failed. They thought it would strengthen their empire. It weakened their empire. They wanted to end the war. Now they're being pulled back in. They wanted to crush reactionary Islamic fundamentalism. They strengthened it. They wanted to strengthen their grip on this whole region. Instead, this region is cracking apart. That's why Obama and Boehner and Netanyahu are at each other's throats, because none of them have answers for this. All this shows that imperialism is not a liberating alternative to fundamentalism and ISIS. We need to bring forward a whole different way. It also shows that this system is not all-powerful. Revolution is possible, but we have to work on that now. We have to fight the crimes of this empire like we are here today. Stop wars of empire. Stop armies of occupation. Stop U.S. crimes against humanity. And stop the war of genocide against our youth, black and brown youth, all out for April 14th. Spread revolution. Get into this new film with Bob Avakian and Cornel West, Revolution and Religion. Fight the power. Transform the people for revolution. Thanks.
Okay, we have a few more speakers left, and we want to make sure to make space to talk about black liberation, about African liberation. So please welcome Akubundu from the All African People's Revolutionary Party.
Greetings. It's good to see everybody. Let me tell you something. Our brother Kwame Ture used to inform us that imperialism doesn't lie some of the time. It lies all the time. And we know it lies all the time. It lies to us about the wars in Palestine. It lies to us about the wars in Iraq. It lies to us about its intentions everywhere on the globe. It seriously lies to us about Africa. It constantly lies to us about Africa. We knew that it was lying to us about Africa when it told us about what was happening in Libya, because we knew what was going on there. These imperialist wars must stop. We cannot allow ourselves to be confused about what is really going on. The reason that it lies is that it is afraid of the truth. Here today, we represent the truth. This is why we're standing together in solidarity to confront the lies that imperialism constantly tells us. Don't believe the lies about Africa. Africa must stand in solidarity. You must stand in solidarity with Africa. I fight in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. These little proxy wars that America funds across the globe, they are still imperialist wars. Don't get it confused. These are not Africans killing Africans. This is imperialism coming to steal the resources of Africa and continually trampling on the people of Africa. So we wanted to come today to stand in solidarity with you beautiful people who are taking time out of your Saturday to come and protest and demonstrate and raise your voice. We invite you also to come to our African Liberation Day celebration, which will be May 23rd in Oakland at the Eastside Arts Alliance. You're all invited, because this is to become an institution where we are able to voice ourselves. We saw what they did with the Mataba in Libya, and this is what we want African Liberation Day to be, a day where solidarity, where struggle is highlighted and the African lives matter. Thank you. Ready for revolution.
Just
so
as I said, our next speaker is Richard Becker of the African Coalition.
Thank you. And I don't think there's anything more important or more important place to be right now than right here, or in one of the other cities across the country where people are speaking out against endless war. You know, since the end of World War II, when the United States really became engaged in the Middle East, there have been 12 presidential administrations. Six of them have been Democrats, and six of them have been Republicans, and all of them have pursued the same aim, the same objective, which is domination, which is control of the oil-rich and strategic region. It has imposed the greatest suffering in the quest to do this, the greatest suffering on people all over the Middle East. 20 years ago, I had the privilege of meeting one of the foremost leaders of the Palestinian struggle, and he said in the course of his remarks, "Take the oil. Take the oil. Just leave us alone." The oil has been a curse for the people. It hasn't benefited them. It's benefited a tiny elite in junior partnership with the oil corporations, the banks, and the military-industrial complex.
Yes.
And this will not change until the people there and the people here make a change. It won't be Congress. It won't be the Supreme Court. It won't be the White House. It'll be the people who bring about the change, because it's always the people who bring about any significant change. So we are going to march in a little while here. One thing we want to ask is that the Atta Coalition, along with other organizations, put on the march today. We spent a good deal of money in doing that. You can see the placards and the banners and thousands of flyers and posters and all of that. And some people are going to come around now with red buckets. And if you want to help us keep the struggle going, you can make a donation. Make a donation as generous as you can. If you want to make a tax-deductible donation, you can write a check to the Progress Unity Fund. Progress Unity Fund. But please, see the people with the red buckets before we leave. Make a donation. Let's keep the struggle going. We want no new war against Iran. U.S. out of Afghanistan. No new war against Iran.
U.S. out of Afghanistan.
No new war against Iran.
U.S. out of Afghanistan.
Free Palestine.
All right, brothers and sisters, you ready to march?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know about that. It seems like you need to drink some water. You ready to march?
Yeah.
All right, brothers and sisters, what we're going to do, we're actually going to go down towards 4th Street, go down to Mission, march around, and then go back to the UN Plaza. So please, let's start getting ready. We need a little bit of setup time. We're going to be setting up behind the flag on the other side, walking towards 4th Street. So please start getting ready. We're going to need a few chants as we're marching, so just bear with us. They're asking for volunteers over here. it says it right there.
Yeah.
Venezuela.
USA.
Iraq to Venezuela.
USA.
Iraq to Venezuela.
USA.
Syria to Venezuela.
USA.
Syria to Venezuela.
USA.
Iraq to Venezuela.
USA.
Iraq to Venezuela.
Thank you.
myself, I grew up on the border, and it's like 120 degrees when you were a kid. But even today, it's warm. So, thanks so much for coming. We're going to have a closing rally with a few speakers. We actually felt it was very appropriate to end at this spot. Behind us is the statue of Simón Bolívar.
Yeah.
Simón Bolívar, a symbol taken back by the Bolivarian Revolution of Venezuela, who today finds himself under constant threat by the U.S. Simón Bolívar, whose ideals has been presented by the Bolivarian Revolution as somebody who tried to unite Latin America against the Empire of the North. The reality about our struggles in Latin America is that they've always known the truth about the North. They've always known that the U.S., from its beginning, was an empire rooted in the killing of Native Americans, an empire that began to colonize the Southern Hemisphere. So for us, naturally, we stand in solidarity with the rest of the people of the world, especially the Middle East, who has also suffered horrendous setbacks thanks to occupation and war. And so we make the connection, sisters and brothers, because too often in this society, we get divided along all sorts of lines. We get told how different we are. We get told why people should be in one space, why a protest should have one symbol, why a protest should say just the Middle East, just Latin America, or should just talk about women's rights, black liberation, Latino, Chicano liberation. But brothers and sisters, the truth is that it's a system. It's an economic system of oppression, built upon oppression, built upon colonization. And so for us today, we see no distinction because we are united in self-determination against the empire.
Hooray!
And so brothers and sisters, we say, you, no justice, no peace. U.S. out of the Middle East, no justice,
no peace.
U.S. out of the Middle East,
no peace. U.S. out of the Middle East, no peace. U.S. out of the Middle East.
Iran to Venezuela, U.S. out. Iran to Venezuela,
U.S. out.
Iran to Venezuela,
U.S. out.
Iran to Venezuela,
U.S. out.
Iran to Venezuela,
U.S. out.
Iran to Venezuela,
U.S. out.
Iran to Venezuela,
U.S. out. Well, I can get you back.
As a son of two Pakistani immigrants and an immigrant myself, I can't imagine the pain that the Palestinians, that the people living under occupation by U.S. weapons and U.S. control feel every day. I moved here as an immigrant back in the fourth grade, and I went through humiliation in the most liberal area that we call, that's called San Francisco. But still, I went through humiliation. The most amazing city that people die to get to, but still, I went through humiliation. One struggle that stuck with me all these years is the Palestinian struggle. And I want to present a piece that I wrote called Mathematics. One bullet is all that it takes to end the precious life of an innocent child. Two parents left standing there in the dust, holding the lifeless form of their baby girl. 3 billion annually of your taxes consistently being sent to a state constantly breaching the 4th Geneva Convention. Death, destruction, they are not bound by dimension. 5 million refugees feeling scorned. 6 wretched days of war. 700,000 civilians subtracted from their homes. 8-meter-high concrete walls, multiplying their weights with land, dividing the territory further, refusing to lay tension to the border, rather snaking their way through villages, isolating them from their resources. 9 millimeters of lead being added to your flesh, 10 minutes increased to 110 minutes. That's the average time that it takes for an ambulance to reach hospitals in towns like Abu Dis and Abu Zariya. 11 students who spoke truth to the power of justice, recognizing the roots of the struggle and embodying it with their own function. 12 out of 12 fractions of the year being lived under poverty and oppression. 13 killed on one side. Friendly fire caused 1,400 irrational deaths on the other. All within a 3-week war. Now, let's take the limit. As X approaches the infinite number of casualties, to calculate the volume of hyperbolic bullcrap your media can store in your mind's matrix. Then, graph the exponential expansion of the upper limits of profit for companies and corporations who benefit from differentiation rather than integration. Finally, factor your decaying degrees of freedom, as well as the convoluted nonsense the binomial politicians input to uphold statistics that I haven't even begin to cover. And what does that equal? It equals nothing. Because equality is not a part of this equation. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Laura Rozelle. I'm with Iraq Veterans Against the War, and I'm here today to give you a small task over a long time. I can't believe how many countries we have represented here today. We're concerned about we're in so many countries right now. We've got to worry about Iran and Venezuela and Syria and Iraq. And it goes on and on and on. I don't know if you can relate to that, but here's one thing you can do. How many of you know a 16-year-old? Who knows a 16-year-old? Who's got a 16-year-old in your neighborhood? Somebody, surely more of you know 16-year-olds, right? Here's the thing. Right now, 16-year-olds can enlist. And I'm going to jump from 16-year-olds to 72-year-olds because I've spent most of 2015, I've spent most of this year so far out taking care of my dad in a hospital in Missouri. He is a Vietnam veteran. He has Parkinson's. He got it from Agent Orange. Our government admits this. If you were in Vietnam and you have Parkinson's, our government automatically pays you a benefit because they know they gave it to you. We were poisoning our own soldiers. Now, the government is setting up Parkinson's centers around the country because 30-year-olds are coming back from Iraq with Parkinson's disease from traumatic brain injury. So we're causing a lot of suffering around the world, but we get lost that we're causing this suffering to our own people. And your job this week and next week and the week after is to help those 16-year-olds stay out of the military. Help wake them up, find something to do, and let's stop the flow of people into the military that then goes out around the world and causes these problems and then brings them back as illness into the U.S.
Open mic.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. My name is Daya. I'm with Ward, Women's Organized Resist and Defense. I'm a Latina from Brazil, and we from Ward, we are together for all the women's rights. And it's shameful that the occupation, the terrorist Ward, they try to justify that to pretend that what they're going to be bringing is more rights to women, when we all know that what they're actually doing, they are killing our brothers, they're killing our husbands, our sons, our fathers, and we as women in the Middle East and everywhere else where the U.S. intervenes, we hold with our own courage and our own strength that our household. And we try to keep our families together when the U.S. is spreading apart and put our brothers in jails, also in the CIA clandestine jails around the world. We are here to stay, and on the International Women's Day, which was March 8th, on the internet there was a lot of photos of brave women in Palestine and how they stand against the Israeli Defense Forces. And we are with those women. We are with them. We are with every single woman where the U.S. is intervening. And now the U.S. is claiming that Venezuela is a threat to the U.S., and we all know it is not. The only threat to the U.S. and its imperialism, its sovereignty, is the power of the people of the world. And when they stand up against it, and we know that's what they meant when they say it's a threat. It's a threat against the imperialists. And we're going to stand. We're going to stand with the woman. We're going to stand with everybody who is standing against the U.S. imperialist war. Thank you.
want to tell you briefly about Mexico. But before that, we know that Obama is totally a farce politic about human rights. Why in Mexico is constantly, every day, our human rights are being violated by the government. And what is this government, what is Obama doing? He's supporting the government in the last decade. It's not only that he supported Calderon with the war against Mexico, against the Mexican people, with the excuse to war the narcos. Right now, Peña Nieto is conducting also a war against Mexicans. We know the media is not telling us what is happening every day, but we know by other means that thousands of people are being disappeared, are being killed, are being in jail. In September last year, 43 students for a normal teacher school disappeared by the state. Those students are seeing the government doesn't offer any response. It has been several months, September to this month, 6 months and months, and we have no response. Mexico and other countries, organizations around the world are organizing caravans in different cities in the state. Last Tuesday, some parents of the 43 students arrived in LA, in Los Angeles. And those parents will visit us in San Francisco April 4th to April 6th. Those parents are looking for solidarity, are expressing the message to us that we need to tell Peña Nieto, that we need to tell Obama that he's enough. I invite you to show up to the march that is for April the 4th at 2 o'clock from 16th Street to 24th. After that, we have a forum on Horace Mann, Buena Vista High School. Please show up. Thank you.
Greetings, everyone. I'm Pirate Mike from Occupy Veterans San Francisco. And we want to draw attention this year to the fact that over 8,000 veterans are committing suicide every year. 22 people are killing themselves every day. Not only is suicide an epidemic in America due to our faulty system and its inability to deal with the human problem, but the fact that big pharmaceutical companies, food companies, agricultural barons, petroleum barons are using our military, abusing our military to further U.S. interests and imperialism abroad. We in Veterans for Peace and Occupy Veterans San Francisco are here to say no to the ongoing war culture. We are here to intervene with the youth who are thinking about joining the military. This thing is beautiful, but the fact is that U.S. war abroad contributes to the U.S. class war here at home. So everyone here, I love you, I respect you as comrades, as brothers, sisters, friends, and lovers, and I abjure you to continue your struggle against U.S. imperialism and the abuse of our military superiority, which contributes to massive death counts here at home. It contributes to massive defunding of education, healthcare, and all the other things we're aware of. My appeal is to the bystanders. I don't want to preach to the choir. I want to sing to the public that the veterans are here to defend our rights to speak out against the war, because we know it firsthand, and we've seen it firsthand here on the streets of San Francisco. So, everybody, continue to stay in contact. build your networks, and let's bring this movement of love and solidarity not only in our neighborhoods, our communities, and our families, but we are here to show the rest of the world that American people, from wherever they originate, are good, wholesome human beings that stand in solidarity with the oppressed people around the world, because this country was born out of oppression. This country was born and built on the backs of people of color and the military veterans who have enabled the U.S. military machine to dominate the world. And we say, no more. The world will know peace when we withdraw from the Middle East.
What a great day it's been. I'm going to just give a very short announcement. A struggle is heating up, as we said, in Latin America. And on April,
the final song, I just wanted to say one more thing that I think is important for us to recognize today, and we've done it in so many ways. It's very important that all of you have come out on this anniversary, that you continue to struggle to end these endless wars. And I just want to say, as a public school teacher here in San Francisco, I teach at a school where 80% of our students are qualified for free and reduced lunch. What does that mean? That means 80% of our students live in such dire poverty that they cannot afford a $3 lunch every day. And my son, who is 5 years old, just received his kindergarten assignment, and I went to learn a little bit more about the school he'd been assigned to, and it's our neighborhood school, and that school also has an 80% free and reduced lunch level. We live in a city with an incredible amount of wealth, where the businesses that line this street pay people hundreds of thousands of dollars to do no productive work. They don't do anything that helps our society thrive and our people thrive. And we live in a place where those people and those companies and the city, the government of this city and this area, are intentionally shoving people out of the city to the point where we're in a situation where I teach in a school and my son will go to a school where 80% of those children are living in extreme poverty. They're doubling up in homes. They're living in SROs. Their families are living in garages and cars just so they can survive and be near the places where they work, and they don't get paid hundreds of thousands of dollars. And in this situation, when we sit in this city, we're here in a demonstration that stands against wars that have cost the government of this country and the people of this country not just the millions of deaths of innocent people around the world, the deaths of soldiers who have been sent there who are working people. They come from our schools. They don't recruit from the people who end up in these offices. They recruit from our schools. And they send them to die. And they send trillions of dollars to do this. And I'm not kidding. Trillions to us is something unimaginable. For regular people who are struggling to make our rent and to pay for food and to find childcare for our children, trillions of dollars is unimaginable. But what does it mean to end those wars? It means those trillions of dollars can pay for schooling for every single person in this country, from preschool through college. It can pay for the hiring of tens of thousands of teachers, tens of thousands of nurses and doctors, and the building of hospitals, the building of schools. It can pay to put those millions of people who are on the streets every day into all those vacant units. You don't even have to take the units. You could pay for it, for the amount of money that exists that is going for war and for occupation. And it is essential for us to understand, and we've continued to build this movement, that there's a connection there we have to make. It is the same people. It is the same people who own Facebook and Google and JP Morgan Chase and the banks, and the same people who work hand in hand with Mayor Ed Lee and President Obama and the whole Congress. They work together to maintain the system that keeps our kids our families in this situation. So we stand here today, and when we say no more war, that's what it means. It means we will bring the funds home, and we will pay reparations to the people we have hurt around the world if we can do that. So before we hear our song, let's stand with our chant. No more war!
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 Money for jobs and education, not for war and occupation. Money for jobs and education,
not for war and occupation.
Money for jobs and education,
not for war and occupation.
When the saints go marching in, oh, when the boys give up war toys, oh, when the boys give up war toys, oh, how I want to be in that number. When the boys give up war toys, oh, when the drums rust in peace, oh, when the drums rust in peace, oh, how I want to be in that number. When the drums rust in peace, oh, when there's peace in the Middle East, oh, when there's peace in the Middle East, oh, how I want to be in that number. When there's peace in the Middle East, oh, when Palestine is free, oh, when Palestine is free, oh, how I want to be in that number. When Palestine is free, oh, when we all have enough to eat, oh, when we all have enough to eat, oh, how I want to be in that number. When we all have enough to eat, oh, when the poor get their rights, oh, when the poor get their rights, oh, how I want to be in that number. When the poor get